They rush on the city, they run on the wall. Great is the army that carries out his word. They rush on the city, they run on the wall. Great is the army that carries out his word. The Lord utters his voice. The Lord is our army. The Lord utters his voice. The Lord is our army. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm.
Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Blow the trumpet in Zion. I'd like to begin our study by going to the fourth commandment of the holy law of God. It's found in Exodus chapter 20 and verses 8 through 11. Exodus 20 and verses 8 through 11. This is the central passage that we studied in our first part of Hidden Sabbath Truths. And basically, when we study this passage of Scripture, we notice that the original reason for the Sabbath was in order to remind us of creation. In other words, it's a commemoration of God's work of creation. I'm going to read the passage so that we can grasp this clearly. Verse 8 says this: "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates." So basically, God is saying, work six, rest the seventh. And then he gives us the reason in verse 11. "For," that means because, "for in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it," or made it holy. In other words, God is clearly saying in the fourth commandment to us, work six and rest the seventh, because at creation I worked six and rested the seventh. In other words, follow my example. In this sense, the Sabbath is a creation ordinance. It comes into existence before sin. It comes into existence before the cross was needed. So the original intention of the Sabbath, the original meaning of the Sabbath, has to do with the fact that it is a sign of creation. However, when sin came into the world, the Sabbath now had an additional function. And we're going to notice that actually it has a third function as we reach the end of our study today. But the Sabbath, as a result of sin, now had a second meaning or a second reason for observing it. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 5, and we're going to read verses 12 through 15. Deuteronomy chapter 5 and verses 12 through 15. This is a repetition of the fourth commandment, but we're going to notice that it has a different motivation clause. In other words, it gives us a different reason for keeping the Sabbath. In Exodus 20, the reason for keeping the Sabbath is a commemoration of creation. In Deuteronomy chapter 5, the motivation for keeping the Sabbath is different. It's the second reason for keeping the Sabbath, the post-fall reason for keeping the Sabbath. It says there in Deuteronomy chapter 5 and verse 12, "Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your manservant, nor your maidservant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor any of your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates, that your manservant and your maidservant may rest as well as you." And now notice the motivation clause. "And remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord your God brought you out from there by a mighty hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day." Now the reason for keeping the Sabbath in this passage is not creation, it is redemption from bondage. And you remember that the sign of the redemption from bondage was the Passover. And the Passover actually pointed forward to the liberation that would come through Jesus Christ. In other words, the Sabbath after the fall has a second reason for its observance. It is a post-fall reason for the observance of the Sabbath, and that is that God who created is also the God who redeems. In other words, the Sabbath is a sign of the Creator, and it is also a sign of the Redeemer. Now, in our subject that we're studying now, we are going to take a look at the Sabbath and its meaning in redemption. In our first study, we noticed the meaning of the Sabbath in creation. Go with me in your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 5, and verses 45 and 46. John chapter 5 and verses 45 and 46. Here Jesus is speaking to the Jews of his day. He's speaking to the Hebrews, to the Israelites. And notice what he says to them. Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. For if you believe Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. Notice in these verses that Jesus is saying to God's people of that day and age, if you believe Moses, that is the writings of Moses, you would believe me because Moses wrote about me. In other words, the central meaning and content of the writings of Moses is myself. Now, in our study, we want to take a look at one of those verses that is found in the writings of Moses which pointed forward to Jesus Christ. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 3, and remember, as we're looking for this verse, that this verse written by Moses points forward to Jesus, because we're told here in John chapter 5 that if the people believed in Moses, they would believe in Jesus because Moses wrote about Jesus. So what I'm saying is that this verse that we're going to look at now is centered in Jesus. Moses was speaking about Jesus. Let's notice Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 3. It's talking about the manna which God sent to Israel. It says there, so he humbled you, that is, Moses is saying, God humbled you, Israel, allowed you to hunger, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know. And now notice the reason why God gave the manna. It wasn't to provide Israel with physical food primarily. It had a deeper intention, a deeper meaning, and that meaning pointed forward to Jesus Christ. Notice the last part says, he gave the manna that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. Why did God give manna? He not only gave manna to satisfy the physical hunger of Israel, but he gave manna in order to teach Israel that man will not live by bread alone, that is physical bread like the manna, but man will live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. In other words, the manna represented the word of God. God gave Israel the manna to teach them that they were to survive, they were to live by the word of God as they were living by consuming the manna that God had provided. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verses 3 and 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verses 3 and 4, we find that the manna was not mainly or primarily physical food. Let's read there in 1 Corinthians 10 and verses 3 and 4. Speaking about Israel's trek through the wilderness, all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. What kind of food was this food? Spiritual food. What kind of drink was this drink? spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. So you see, the manna had a deeper intention, a deeper meaning than just being physical food. The manna was a spiritual food. The manna represented the Word of God.
Yah commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear Yah, our Elohim, for our good always, that He might preserve us alive, as it is at this day. And it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before Yah, our Elohim, as He has commanded us. Praise you, Father Yah.
I will not have any other Elohim before you, nor bow down to any graven images too. I will take the name of Yah, my Elohim, in vain. I'll do.
I'll do. Now the question is, who is the Word of God according to Scripture? Jesus. Go with me to John chapter 1 and verses 1 to 3. John chapter 1 and verses 1 to 3. Here we're going to find who is the Word according to Scripture. It says there, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Who is this Word? Jesus. Later on it says that the Word was made flesh. It says in verse 2, "He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made that was made." So God gave the manna to teach Israel that they should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And the Word of God is Jesus. He was trying to teach Israel that the only way that they could subsist spiritually was to partake of whom? Was to partake of Jesus, the Word of God, who was symbolized by the manna. Now in John chapter 6, in verses 48 to 51, we find Jesus explicitly referring to the manna. And he applies the manna to himself, spiritually speaking. John 6 and verse 48, and we'll read on till verse 51. Here Jesus is speaking to a group of Jewish people, and he says, "I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread, and now notice this is very important, and the bread that I shall give is what? Is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. So what did the manna represent more specifically? The manna represented the flesh of Jesus. Did you catch that? I'm going to read it once again. The last part. Actually, verse 51. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, that is of me, because he's the one who came down from heaven, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. So we found that the manna represents the Word of God. The Word of God is Jesus. And Jesus says that the manna represents primarily his what? His flesh. That's what the manna represents. Now, why is this important? Go with me to Exodus chapter 16, and let's read verses 19 and 20. Exodus 16, verses 19 and 20. We're going to remember or recall the experience of the manna that fell in the wilderness. What happened if the manna was picked up on Tuesday and it was saved for Wednesday? It had two characteristics. We're going to read that in a moment. Number one, it bred worms and it stank. Two characteristics, bred worms and stank. I want you to remember that. If it was picked up on Monday for Tuesday, Tuesday for Wednesday, Wednesday for Thursday, Thursday for Friday, Sunday for Monday, invariably, it bred worms and stank if you saved it for the next day. But what happened when the manna was picked up on Friday and the people took it out on the Sabbath? The Bible says that the manna did not breed worms or stink. In fact, it was as fresh as ever. Let's read Exodus 16, verses 19 and 20. And Moses said, he's speaking to Israel, let no one leave any of it till morning. Notwithstanding, they did not heed Moses, but some of them left part of it until the morning. And it bred worms and stank, and Moses was angry with them. So notice when they picked it up for one day, for the next, other than on the Sabbath, the manna bred worms and stank. But what about when it was picked up on Friday for Sabbath? Notice Exodus 16 and verses 23 and 24. Then he said to them, this is Moses speaking to the congregation, this is what the Lord has said. Tomorrow is a Sabbath of rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. Bake what you will bake today, and boil what you will boil, and lay up for yourselves all that remains to be kept until the morning. Verse 24, so they laid it up till morning as Moses commanded, and it did not stink, nor were there any worms in it. So when the manna was picked up on Friday and saved for the Sabbath, the manna was as fresh on the Sabbath as it had been on Friday. Now, what did God want to teach by this miracle that he performed? Well, we need to remember that the manna represents whom? The manna represents Jesus. What particular aspect of Jesus? His flesh, which he was going to give for the world. Jesus himself said so. So the manna represented the flesh of Jesus. Now let's take a look at what happened a little less than 1,500 years later down in history when Jesus comes. It is the sixth day of the week, Friday. In fact, the Gospels call it the preparation. And it's late on Friday. It's late on the sixth day of the week. And Jesus is hanging on the cross of Calvary, and he's about to finish his works of redemption. In other words, the manna is a symbol of Jesus. And Jesus, the sixth day, which is the day in which the manna fell, where they were supposed to pick it up for the Sabbath, and it was not going to spoil, breed worms, or stink on the Sabbath, Jesus says those famous words, "It is finished." Does Genesis say that after creation, he finished his works? That very word is used. He finished his works of creation. Now, on the sixth day, Jesus says, "It is finished." And by the way, it is late on the sixth day. The sun is about to set on the sixth day. The sixth day is about to end. Notice John chapter 19 and verse 30, the words that Jesus spoke on the cross. He's going to say, "I have finished now the works of redemption." And he finishes late on the sixth day. It says there in John 19 verse 30, "So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit." Now I want you to notice the sequence of days that we have here. Go with me to Luke chapter 23, and we're going to read verses 54 to 56. I want the sequence of days to be clear in your mind, because some people say, "Well, how do you know that Sunday is not the seventh day?" Do you know that's common today for people to say that Sunday is the seventh day? Well, the fact is that that's impossible. Sunday is not the seventh day. The Bible says that Sunday is the first day. It's the day in which Jesus resurrected. So much for the calendars in Europe. I have nothing against the Europeans, but in many countries, the calendar begins on Monday, which means that which day would be the seventh day? Sunday would be the seventh day. But that does not square with Holy Scripture. Notice Luke 23 and beginning with verse 54. It says here, "This man, Joseph of Arimathea, went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock, where no one had ever lain before. That day," the day when he said it is finished, "that day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near." What was about to begin? The Sabbath was about to begin. "And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on Sunday according to the commandment." Thank you. I knew that you would protest. I just wanted to make sure that you were awake out there. It says that they rested which day? On the Sabbath according to the commandment. Let me ask you then, which day did Jesus die? He died on Friday. What time on Friday? Very late. Almost when the day is ending, when the Sabbath is going to start. What is the day after the death of Jesus? It's the Sabbath, which is what number of the days of the week? It's number 7, because in the very next verse, Luke 24 and verse 1, it says that Jesus resurrected early on the first day of the week, which means that on the seventh day, Jesus rested where? He rested in the grave. In fact, let's read again John 6 and verse 51, because it's very important that we understand this specific verse when it comes to what happened to Jesus while he lay in the grave. He says there, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give," notice, "is my flesh which I shall give for the life of the world." So the manna represented the flesh of Jesus. When the manna was picked up on Friday, no worms, and it didn't stink on the Sabbath. Let me ask you, when Jesus rested in the tomb on the Sabbath day, Did his flesh begin the process of decomposing? No, it didn't. His body was as fresh on the Sabbath as it had been on Friday when he died. Notice the prophecy, the messianic prophecy that we find in Psalm 16 and verses 8 through 10. Psalm 16 and verses 8 through 10. This is a prophecy about the Messiah. It says there, I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. Notice, my body also will rest secure. By the way, do you know that that word that is translated body in the New International Version, that is not the best translation. The King James translates that word in a more proper fashion. You see, in the Greek language, the word for body is soma. That's not the word that is used here, soma. The word for flesh is sarx. The word that is used here is sarx. In other words, flesh. It's the very word that is used in John 6, verse 51, which connects John 6, 51. The manna is the flesh, my flesh that I will give for the world, is the same word that is translated body here in the New International Version. And so really what it says is, therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices, my flesh also will rest secure. Or as the King James says, my flesh will rest in hope. What does the flesh of Jesus do? At what? It rests in hope. Why? Because his body is in the tomb. Which day? His body is in the tomb on the seventh day Sabbath. Verse 10. Because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. Are you catching what this is saying? The body or the flesh of the Messiah was going to rest in the grave in hope. And his body was not going to see corruption. His body was not going to decay. And the question is, why is it that his body was not going to decay? Because Jesus was the living what? He was the living manna. And when the manna was picked up on Friday for the Sabbath, it was as fresh on the Sabbath as it was on Friday. So Jesus died on Friday, and his body was as fresh on the Sabbath as it had been on Friday. His body did not begin to decompose. Someone might say, Pastor, is this really a messianic prophecy? Well, let's go to the sermon of the Apostle Peter on the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2. In verses 25 to 27, Acts chapter 2, 25 to 27, once again, I'm reading in the New International Version, with the exception of the word body, which really should be translated flesh, it's a good translation. Notice Peter preaching on the day of Pentecost. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body, once again, it's the word sarx in Greek. My body also will live in hope. By the way, the word that is used in the Greek Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, is sarx. So we know that it should not be soma, it should be sarx. Verse 27, because you will not abandon me to the grave, the King James Version says, you will not leave what? My soul in hell. The New International Version says, you will not allow me to remain in the grave. So the soul is me and hell is the grave. Are you catching the point? And so it says in verse 27, because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. And then let's go down to verse 31, Acts chapter 2 and verse 31. Now Peter is going to interpret the meaning of this passage. He says, seeing what was ahead, he spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to the grave, nor did his body, once again it should be flesh, nor did his flesh see decay.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
Have you ever heard of those people who teach that the crucifixion took place on Wednesday and Jesus resurrected on Sabbath? This prophecy makes that impossible. Jesus could not have been crucified on a Wednesday and resurrected on a Sabbath to fulfill this prophecy. Because the only day in which the manna fell, when it was as fresh the next day as the day it fell, was when it was picked up on Friday for the Sabbath. Not Wednesday for the Sabbath, not Thursday for the Sabbath, Friday for the Sabbath. So this shows that really the Messiah was going to die on which day? On Friday, and his body was going to rest in hope, and his body was not going to see decay. It was not, in other words, going to breed worms or to stink. Now somebody might say, Pastor Bohr, are you saying then that eating the manna means that we eat the physical flesh of Jesus? No. We need to understand the way in which Jesus says that we assimilate him as the manna. We assimilate his flesh. It's not by eating his physical flesh. It's actually by consuming his word. Notice John chapter 6 and verse 63. Because when Jesus said these words, the people said, oh, this man is teaching us to be cannibals. He's saying we should eat his flesh. That's gross. That's forbidden in the law of Moses. You see, Jesus wasn't saying, eat my physical flesh. His physical flesh is assimilated by studying the word, because Jesus physically is composed of flesh, but his word is Jesus in written form. Now notice John 6, 63. Jesus says to these people, it is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. In other words, it doesn't do you any good to eat my physical flesh. Then he says this, the words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. In other words, we assimilate the flesh of Jesus through partaking of his word, because the manna represented the physical flesh of Jesus, and the physical flesh of Jesus represented his written word. By the way, 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 23 speaks of the word of God being incorruptible just like his body was. Notice what it says there in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 23. It says, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but of what? Incorruptible. Through what? Through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. And so interestingly enough, the Sabbath not only points backwards to creation, but the Sabbath also in the Old Testament pointed forward to what Jesus was going to do when he died on the cross. The sixth day, towards the end of the day, he was going to say, it is finished. His body was going to be placed in the tomb. On Sabbath, it was going to rest in hope. His flesh was not going to see decay. It was not going to see corruption, because he was the living manna. In other words, we have a beautiful messianic prophecy here in John chapter 6, as we compare it with Numbers, with Exodus chapter 16. But do you know that the Sabbath has another dimension? The Sabbath also has a future significance. And this future significance would have never come up unless man had sinned. Are you understanding that the Sabbath has a primary significance and it has secondary applications as well after sin? Before sin, the purpose of the Sabbath is to commemorate creation. After sin, it still commemorates creation, but now it also points forward to redemption, where the Creator is going to finish his works the sixth day, is going to rest in the tomb on the seventh day, like he did at the beginning from his works of creation. And the Sabbath also points forwards to the end of time, when God will create a new heavens and a new earth, which is necessary because of sin. In fact, let's go to Isaiah chapter 66 and read verses 22 and 23. Isaiah 66, 22 and 23. It says there, for as the new heavens and the new earth which I will make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your descendants and your name remain. Is this verse talking about new heavens and a new earth? God making the new heavens and the new earth? Absolutely. Verse 23. And it shall come to pass in this new heavens and new earth that from one new moon to another, by the way, new moon could be translated from one month to another, because the new moon marked the beginning of the months. among the Hebrews. You know that the months are lunar months. Am I correct? Even today, the months are reckoned by the moon, and the days are reckoned by the sun. So in other words, it could be translated from month to month. And then it says, and from one Sunday to another. You're still out there and awake. It says, and from one Sabbath to another, all the Jews shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. It doesn't say all the Jews. So the new heavens and the new earth is just for the Jews. Of course not. It says here, from one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord. Now the question is, why are we going to go there to worship before the Lord from month to month? Obviously, we're going to go and worship before His throne, because that's where, according to Revelation, people are going to bow before God, on the sea of glass before His throne. So why are we going to go every month? Well, Revelation 22, verses 1 and 2 has the explanation. See, Revelation explains the Old Testament. You can't understand Revelation without going back to the Old Testament. So those who say that they're New Testament Christians are really studying with one hand behind their back, tied behind their back. Notice what it says there in Revelation 22, verses 1 and 2. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And what is there? In the middle of its street, and on either side of the river, was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. So why is it that we are going to go to worship before the Lord every month? Clearly, we are told here that we will go to partake of the tree of life. Did you know that we, even in the kingdom come, are going to be conditionally immortal? In other words, we will continue to live because we will continue to eat from God's tree. We will not be inherently immortal. Our immortality will be derived from God's tree. We will have to go every month to eat from the tree of life to continue living forever and ever. But then there's the issue of going every Sabbath. Why are we going to go to worship before the Lord from Sabbath to Sabbath? Folks, Isaiah 66 makes it clear. It says that it's because God is going to make a new what? God is going to make a new heavens and a new earth. Now the question is, why would God have to make a new heavens and a new earth? The book of Revelation makes it very clear. You see, when Jesus comes back to this earth, the earth is going to return to the condition it was at the beginning before creation. You remember that in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2, it says that the earth was without form and void, and the planet was what? In darkness. Notice Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse 23. Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse 23, speaking about the condition of the earth after the second coming of Jesus. It says there in Jeremiah 4 verse 23, I beheld the earth, and indeed it was without form and void, and the heavens, they had no light. So let me ask you, is this planet going to return to the chaotic condition it was in before creation? Absolutely. So what is God going to have to do? He's going to have to make a new heavens and a new earth, just like He made when? Just like He made at the beginning. In other words, He is going to suspend His rest from creation. Are you understanding me? In other words, God, since creation, as we studied in our first subject, has ceased His work of creation. In other words, the evening and the morning of the seventh day has not come for God, because God has created no more with regards to this earth. But when this earth returns to the condition it was in before creation, God is going to break his rest, and he's going to start creating again. Let me ask you, how many days do you think God is going to use to create again this world? Now, where did you get that idea from, that it would be 6 days? You know, I used to think that when God makes the new heavens and the new earth, he's going to say, let there be the new heavens and the new earth. It's all there. But it can't be. You say, why not? Because in Isaiah 66, we are told that we are going to worship before the Lord from Sabbath to Sabbath in commemoration of the creation of the new heavens and the new earth. Now, you cannot keep the seventh day unless you have the first six, because the seventh is reckoned on the basis of the first 6 days. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So if we're going to go from Sabbath to Sabbath to worship before the Lord, it must mean that there are 6 days before that Sabbath, which means that God, when he recreates this heaven, this earth, and he remakes the heavens. By the way, do you know why he has to remake the heavens and the earth? Go with me to Matthew chapter 24 and verse 29. Matthew 24 and verse 29 tells us what's going to happen when Jesus comes. It says there, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. What's going to happen with the sun, the moon, and the stars? They're going to be thrown out of their orbits. The powers of the heavens shall be shaken. By the way, who are the powers that rule the heavens? The sun and the moon. Notice Genesis chapter 1 and verse 16. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 16. When God created the sun and the moon, notice what he created them for. It says, then God made two great lights. The greater light to do what? To rule the day. And the lesser light, which is the moon, to what? To rule the night. He made the stars also. So who are the powers of the heavens that rule the heavens? It is the sun and the moon. Let me ask you, when Jesus comes, are the sun and the moon going to be thrown out of their orbits? Yes, they are. And that's the reason why during the millennium we're told that the earth is going to be in what? The earth is going to be in darkness. Because our whole solar system is going to be thrown out of whack, so to speak. So is Jesus going to have to reorganize the heavens and the earth? He most certainly is. And he's going to do it in 6 days. Now here's the marvelous thing. At the beginning, when God made the heavens and the earth and worked 6 days to create the heavens and the earth, Adam and Eve were not eyewitnesses. Because God made everything before he created Adam and Eve. And furthermore, when he made Eve after Adam, but he put Adam to sleep. And so Adam did not see the creation of Eve. Adam and Eve did not see God create anything. In other words, they had to take Jesus, God, at his word. When he said, I was the creator, I made everything, they had to believe it because he said it. In other words, they had to walk by faith, not by sight. But the beautiful thing is, at the end of time, it's going to be different, because God's people are going to be alive. Can you imagine what it's going to be like when God is going to remake this earth again and organize it like he did at the beginning, put it in order and fill it? And he says the first day, let there be light, and light appears. And then he says, now I have to let 24 hours go by. 24 hours go by, then he says, okay, now second day, let there be the firmament. And God's people are there watching what he's doing. Then the third day he says, let there be productive land. Let there be trees and plants and flowers. And so all over the earth you have these beautiful plants and flowers and trees sprouting out. And then God says, let the sun, the moon, and the stars occupy their places again. And he's going to organize the cosmos. He's going to organize the heavens. He's going to place the sun, the moon, and the stars where they were before they were thrown out of their orbits when Jesus came. And then the fifth day, he's going to say, let the skies have birds in them, and let the waters be filled with fish. They all died as a result of the plagues. And then the sixth day, he's going to say, let the earth produce living creatures, and he's going to create all of these wonderful animals that we've come to love. Now, some people say, Pastor Bohr, there's not going to be any monthly and weekly cycle in the kingdom. Haven't you ever read Revelation 21, verse 23? Well, let's go to that verse and take a look at it. Revelation chapter 21 and verse 23. And let's read it carefully. We need to read things carefully. It says there, the city, the what? The city had no need. Does it say that the city doesn't have them? No. Does it say that that there's not going to be all over the earth? No. It's the city, and the city has no what? No need. See, we got to read carefully. The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. Maybe I can illustrate it. How many of you have seen a person with a flashlight trying to find their way around at high noon? I mean, if you shine your flashlight on the ground on a 110-degree day in Fresno, when the sun is beating down, can you even see the ray on the sidewalk? No. It's shining, but the light of the sun is so bright, that you actually, it's like you don't even have a flashlight. That's what's going to happen with the sun and the moon. The sun and the moon are going to have to step aside, and they're going to allow the glory of God to shine in the holy city. Notice also Isaiah chapter 24 and verse 23. Isaiah 24 and verse 23. This is related to what we just read in Revelation 21 verse 23. It says there, speaking about after the millennium when God makes a new heavens and the new earth, it says, then the moon will be disgraced. It doesn't say that the moon is going to disappear. It says the moon will be disgraced. And the sun ashamed. How come? It says, for the Lord of hosts will reign on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem before his elders gloriously.
Inspired by the Bible Experience.
Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land that the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years to humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that people do not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in obedience to him and revering him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with streams and pools of water, with springs flowing in the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey. A land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing. A land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors as it is today. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. Like the nations the Lord destroyed before you, so you will be destroyed for not obeying the Lord your God. Hear, Israel. You are now about to cross the Jordan to go win and dispossess nations greater and stronger than you, with large cities that have walls up to the sky. The people are strong and tall. Anakites, you know about them, and have heard it said, who can stand up against the Anakites? But be assured today that the Lord your God is the one who goes across ahead of you. Like a devouring fire, he will destroy them. He will subdue them before you, and you will drive them out and annihilate them quickly, as the Lord has promised you. After the Lord your God has driven them out before you, do not say to yourself, the Lord has brought me here to take possession of this land because of my righteousness. No, it is on account of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is going to drive them out before you. It is not because of your righteousness or your integrity that you are going in to take possession of their land, but on account of the wickedness of these nations, the Lord your God will drive them out before you to accomplish what he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Understand then that it is not because of your righteousness that the Lord your God is giving you this good land to possess, for you are a stiff-necked people. Remember this, and never forget how you aroused the anger of the Lord your God in the wilderness. From the day you left Egypt until you arrived here, you have been rebellious against the Lord. At Horeb, you aroused the Lord's wrath so that he was angry enough to destroy you. When I went up on the mountain to receive the tablets of stone, the tablets of the covenant that the Lord had made with you, I stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. I ate no bread and drank no water. The Lord gave me 2 stone tablets inscribed by the finger of God. On them were all the commandments the Lord proclaimed to you on the mountain out of the fire on the day of the assembly. At the end of the 40 days and 40 nights, the Lord gave me the 2 stone tablets, the tablets of the covenant. Then the Lord told me, go down from here at once, because your people whom you brought out of Egypt have become corrupt. They have turned away quickly from what I commanded them and have made an idol for themselves. And the Lord said to me, I have seen this people, and they are a stiff-necked people indeed. Let me alone so that I may destroy them and blot out their name from under heaven, and I will make you into a nation stronger and more numerous than they. So I turned and went down from the mountain while it was ablaze with fire. And the 2 tablets of the covenant were in my hands. When I looked, I saw that you had sinned against the Lord your God. You had made for yourselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. You had turned aside quickly from the way that the Lord had commanded you. So I took the 2 tablets and threw them out of my hands, breaking them to pieces before your eyes. Then once again I fell prostrate before the Lord. For 40 days and 40 nights, I ate no bread and drank no water because of all the sin you had committed, doing what was evil in the Lord's sight and so arousing his anger. I feared the anger and wrath of the Lord, for he was angry enough with you to destroy you. But again the Lord listened to me and the Lord was angry enough with Aaron to destroy him. But at that time I prayed for Aaron too. Also, I took that sinful thing of yours, the calf you had made, and burned it in the fire. Then I crushed it and ground it to powder as fine as dust, and threw the dust into a stream that flowed down the mountain. You also made the Lord angry at Taberah, at Massa, and at Kibroth Hataava. And when the Lord sent you out from Kadesh Barnea, he said, go up and take possession of the land I have given you. But you rebelled against the command of the Lord your God. You did not trust him or obey him. You have been rebellious against the Lord ever since I have known you. I lay prostrate before the Lord those 40 days and 40 nights, because the Lord had said he would destroy you. I prayed to the Lord and said, Sovereign Lord, do not destroy your people, your own inheritance, that you redeemed by your great power and brought out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Overlook the stubbornness of this people, their wickedness and their sin. Otherwise, the country from which you brought us will say, because the Lord was not able to take them into the land he had promised them, and because he hated them, he brought them out to put them to death in the wilderness. But they are your people, your inheritance, that you brought out by your great power and your outstretched arm. At that time the Lord said to me, chisel out two stone tablets like the first ones and come up to me on the mountain. Also make a wooden ark. I will write on the tablets the words that were on the first tablets which you broke. Then you are to put them in the ark. So I made the ark out of acacia wood and chiseled out two stone tablets like the first ones. And I went up on the mountain with the two tablets in my hands. The Lord wrote on these tablets what he had written before, the Ten Commandments he had proclaimed to you on the mountain out of the fire on the day of the assembly. And the Lord gave them to me. Then I came back down the mountain and put the tablets in the ark I had made, as the Lord commanded me, and they are there now. The Israelites traveled from the wells of Bene Jeuka to Masera. There Aaron died and was buried, and Eleazar his son succeeded him as priest. From there they traveled to Gudgoda and on to Jotbatha, a land with streams of water. At that time the Lord set apart the tribe of Levi to carry the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, to stand before the Lord, to minister, and to pronounce blessings in his name, as they still do today. That is why the Levites have no share or inheritance among their fellow Israelites. The Lord is their inheritance, as the Lord your God told them. Now I had stayed on the mountain 40 days and nights, as I did the first time, and the Lord listened to me at this time also. It was not his will to destroy you. Go, the Lord said to me, and lead the people on their way so that they may enter and possess the land that I swore to their ancestors to give them. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of you but to fear the Lord your God? To walk in obedience to him, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to observe the Lord's commands and decrees that I am giving you today for your own. To the Lord your God belong the heavens, even the highest heavens, the earth and everything in it, Yet the Lord set his affection on your ancestors and loved them. And he chose you, their descendants, above all the nations, as it is today. Circumcise your hearts, therefore, and do not be stiff-necked any longer. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow, and loves the foreigners residing among you, giving them food and clothing. And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt. Fear the Lord your God and serve him. Hold fast to him and take your oaths in his name. He is your praise. He is your God, who performed for you those great and awesome wonders you saw with your own eyes. Your ancestors who went down into Egypt were 70 in all, and now the Lord your God has made you as numerous as the stars in the sky. Love the Lord your God and keep his requirements, his decrees, his laws, and his commands always. Remember today that your children were not the ones who saw and experienced the discipline of the Lord your God, his majesty, his mighty hand, his outstretched arm, the signs he performed, and the things he did in the heart of Egypt, both to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and to his whole country. What he did to the Egyptian army, to its horses and chariots, how he overwhelmed them with the waters of the Red Sea as they were pursuing you, and how the Lord brought lasting ruin on them. It was not your children who saw what he did for you in the wilderness until you arrived at this place, and what he did to Dathan and Abiram, sons of Eliab, the Reubenite, when the earth opened its mouth right in the middle of all Israel and swallowed them up with their households, their tents, and every living thing that belonged to them. But it was your own eyes that saw all these great things the Lord has done. Observe, therefore, all the commands I am giving you today, so that you may have the strength to go in and take over the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, and so that you may live long in the land that the Lord swore to your ancestors to give to them and their descendants, a land flowing with milk and honey. The land you are entering to take over is not like the land of Egypt from which you have come, where you planted your seed and irrigated it by foot as in a vegetable garden. But the land you are crossing the Jordan to take possession of is a land of mountains and valleys that drinks rain from heaven. It is a land the Lord your God cares for. The eyes of the Lord your God are continually on it from the beginning of the year to its end. So if you faithfully obey the commands I am giving you today, to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, then I will send rain on your land in its season, both autumn and spring rains, so that you may gather in your grain, new wine and olive oil. I will provide grass in the fields for your cattle, and you will eat and be satisfied. Be careful, or you will be enticed to turn away and worship other gods and bow down to them. Then the Lord's anger will burn against you, and he will shut the heavens so that it will not rain, and the ground will yield no produce, and you will soon perish from the good land the Lord is giving you. Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates, so that your days and the days of your children may be many in the land that the Lord swore to give your ancestors, as many as the days that the heavens are above the earth. If you carefully observe all these commands I am giving you to follow, to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to Him, and to hold fast to Him, then the Lord will drive out all these nations before you, and you will dispossess nations larger and stronger than you. Every place where you set your foot will be yours. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the Euphrates River to the Mediterranean Sea. No one will be able to stand against you. The Lord your God, as He promised you, will put the terror and fear of you on the whole land, wherever you go. See, I am setting before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing if you obey the commands of the Lord your God that I am giving you today. The curse if you disobey the commands of the Lord your God and turn from the way that I command you today by following other gods which you have not known. When the Lord your God has brought you into the land you are entering to possess, you are to proclaim on Mount Gerizim the blessings and on Mount Ebal the curses. As you know, these mountains are across the Jordan, westward toward the setting sun, near the great trees of Moreh, in the territory of those Canaanites living in the Arabah, in the vicinity of Gilgal. You are about to cross the Jordan, to enter and take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you. When you have taken it over and are living there, be sure that you obey all the decrees and laws I am setting before you today. These are the decrees and laws you must be careful to follow in the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, has given you to possess as long as you live in the land. Destroy completely all the places on the high mountains, on the hills, and under every spreading tree where the nations you are dispossessing worship their gods. Break down their altars, smash their sacred stones, and burn their Asherah poles in the fire. Cut down the idols of their gods and wipe out their names from those places. You must not worship the Lord your God in their way, but you are to seek the place the Lord your God will choose from among all your tribes to put His name there for His dwelling. To that place you must go there. Bring your burnt offerings and sacrifices, your tithes and special gifts, what you have vowed to give, and your freewill offerings, and the firstborn of your herds and flocks. There, in the presence of the Lord your God, you and your family shall eat and shall rejoice in everything you have put your hand to, because the Lord your God has blessed you. You are not to do as we do here today, everyone doing as they see fit.
since you have not yet reached the resting place and the inheritance the Lord your God is giving you. But you will cross the Jordan and settle in the land the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance, and he will give you rest from all your enemies around you, so that you will live in safety. Then to the place the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. There you are to bring everything I command you, your burnt offerings and sacrifices, your tithes and special gifts, and all the choice possessions you have vowed to the Lord. And there rejoice before the Lord your God, you, your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, and the Levites from your towns who have no allotment or inheritance of their own. Be careful not to sacrifice your burnt offerings anywhere you please. Offer them only at the place the Lord will choose in one of your tribes, and there observe everything I command you. Nevertheless, you may slaughter your animals in any of your towns and eat as much of the meat as you want, as if it were gazelle or deer, according to the blessing the Lord your God gives you. Both the ceremonially unclean and the clean may eat it, but you must not eat the blood. Pour it out on the ground like water. You must not eat in your own towns the tithe of your grain, and new wine and olive oil, or the firstborn of your herds and flocks, or whatever you have vowed to give, or your freewill offerings, or special gifts. Instead, you are to eat them in the presence of the Lord your God, at the place the Lord your God will choose. You, your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, and the Levites from your towns. And you are to rejoice before the Lord your God in everything you put your hand to. Be careful not to neglect the Levites as long as you live in your land. When the Lord your God has enlarged your territory as he promised you, and you crave meat and say, I would like some meat, then you may eat as much of it as you want. If the place where the Lord your God chooses to put his name is too far away from you, you may slaughter animals from the herds and flocks the Lord has given you, as I have commanded you. And in your own towns you may eat as much of them as you want. Eat them as you would gazelle or deer. Both the ceremonially unclean and the clean may eat. But be sure you do not eat the blood, because the blood is the life, and you must not eat the life with the meat. You must not eat the blood. Pour it out on the ground like water. Do not eat it, so that it may go well with you and your children after you, because you will be doing what is right in the eyes of the Lord. But take your consecrated things and whatever you have vowed to give, and go to the place the Lord will choose. Present your burnt offerings on the altar of the Lord your God, both the meat and the blood. The blood of your sacrifices must be poured beside the altar of the Lord your God, but you may eat the meat. Be careful to obey all these regulations I am giving you, so that it may always go well with you and your children after you. Because you will be doing what is good and right in the eyes of the Lord your God. The Lord your God will cut off before you the nations you are about to invade and dispossess. But when you have driven them out and settled in their land, and after they have been destroyed before you. Be careful not to be ensnared by inquiring about their gods, saying, how do these nations serve their gods? We will do the same. You must not worship the Lord your God in their way, because in worshiping their gods, they do all kinds of detestable things the Lord hates. They even burn their sons and daughters in the fire as sacrifices to their gods. See that you do all I command you. Do not add to it or take away from it. If a prophet, or one who foretells by dreams, appears among you and announces to you a sign or wonder, and if the sign or wonder spoken of takes place, and the prophet says, let us follow other gods, gods you have not known, and let us worship them, you must not listen to the words of that prophet or dreamer. The Lord your God is testing you to find out whether you love him with all your heart and with all your soul. It is the Lord your God you must follow, and him you must revere. Keep his commands and obey him, serve him, and hold fast to him. That prophet or dreamer must be put to death for inciting rebellion against the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. That prophet or dreamer tried to turn you from the way the Lord your God commanded you to follow. You must purge the evil from among you. If your very own brother, or your son or daughter, or the wife you love, or your closest friend secretly entices you, saying, let us go and worship other gods, gods that neither you nor your ancestors have known, gods of the peoples around you, whether near or far, from one end of the land to the other. Do not yield to them or listen to them. Show them no pity. Do not spare them or shield them. You must certainly put them to death. Your hand must be the first in putting them to death, and then the hands of all the people. Stone them to death, because they tried to turn you away from the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Then all Israel will hear and be afraid, and no one among you will do such an evil thing again. If you hear it said about one of the towns the Lord your God is giving you to live in, that wicked persons have arisen among you and have led the people of their town astray, saying, let us go and worship other gods, gods you have not known, then you must inquire, probe, and investigate it thoroughly. And if it is true, and it has been proved that this detestable thing has been done among you, you must certainly put to the sword all who live in that town. Destroy it completely, both its people and its livestock. Gather all the plunder of the town into the middle of the public square, and completely burn the town and all its plunder as a whole burnt offering to the Lord your God. It is to remain a ruin forever, never to be rebuilt. None of those condemned things shall be found in your hands. So that the Lord will turn from his fierce anger, he will show you mercy, have compassion on you, and increase your numbers as he promised on oath to your ancestors. Because you obey the Lord your God, keeping all his commands that I am giving you today, and doing what is right in his eyes. You are the children of the Lord your God. Do not cut yourselves or shave the front of your heads for the dead, for you are a people holy to the Lord your God. Out of all the peoples on the face of the earth, the Lord has chosen you to be his treasured possession. Do not eat any detestable thing. These are the animals you may eat: the ox, the sheep, the goat, the deer, the gazelle, the roe deer, the wild goat, the ibex, the antelope, and the mountain sheep. You may eat any animal that has a divided hoof and that chews the cud. However, of those that chew the cud or that have a divided hoof, you may not eat the camel, the rabbit, or the hayrax. Although they chew the cud, they do not have a divided hoof. They are ceremonially unclean for you. The pig is also unclean. Although it has a divided hoof, it does not chew the cud. You are not to eat their meat or touch their carcasses. Of all the creatures living in the water, you may eat any that has fins and scales. But anything that does not have fins and scales, you may not eat. For you, it is unclean. You may eat any clean bird. But these you may not eat: the eagle, the vulture, the black vulture, the red kite, the black kite, any kind of falcon, any kind of raven, the horned owl, the screech owl, the gull, any kind of hawk, the little owl, the great owl, the white owl, the desert owl, the osprey, the cormorant, the stork, any kind of heron, the hoopoe, and the bat, all flying insects that swarm are unclean to you. Do not eat them. But any winged creature that is clean, you may eat. Do not eat anything you find already dead. You may give it to the foreigners residing in any of your towns, and they may eat it. Or you may sell it to any other foreigner, but you are a people holy to the Lord your God. Do not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. Be sure to set aside a tenth of all that your fields produce each year. Eat the tithe of your grain, new wine, and olive oil, and the firstborn of your herds and flocks in the presence of the Lord your God at the place he will choose as a dwelling for his name, so that you may learn to revere the Lord your God always. But if that place is too distant, and you have been blessed by the Lord your God, and cannot carry your tithe, because the place where the Lord will choose to put his name is so far away, then exchange your tithe for silver, and take the silver with you, and go to the place the Lord your God will choose. Use the silver to buy whatever you like, cattle, sheep, wine, or other fermented drink, or anything you wish. Then you and your household shall eat there in the presence of the Lord your God and rejoice. And do not neglect the Levites living in your towns, for they have no allotment or inheritance of their own. At the end of every 3 years, bring all the tithes of that year's produce and store it in your towns, so that the Levites, who have no allotment or inheritance of their own, and the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows who live in your towns may come and eat and be satisfied, and so that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. At the end of every 7 years, you must cancel debts. This is how it is to be done. Every creditor shall cancel any loan they have made to another Israelite. They shall not require payment from anyone among their own people, because the Lord's time for canceling debts has been proclaimed. You may require payment from a foreigner, but you must cancel any debt one of your people owes you. However, there need be no poor people among you, for in the land the Lord your God is giving you to possess as your inheritance, he will richly bless you, if only you fully obey the Lord your God and are careful to follow all these commands I am giving you today. For the Lord your God will bless you as he has promised, and you will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. You will rule over many nations, but none will rule over you. If anyone is poor among your people in any of the towns of the land that the Lord your God is giving you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward them. Rather, be open-handed and freely lend them whatever they need. Be careful not to harbor this wicked thought. The seventh year, the year for canceling debts, is near, so that you do not show ill will toward the needy among your people and give them nothing. They may then appeal to the Lord against you, and you will be found guilty of sin. Give generously to them and do so without a grudging heart. Then, because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hand to. There will always be poor people in the land. Therefore, I command you to be open-handed toward those of your people who are poor and needy in your land. If any of your people, men or women, sell themselves to you and serve you 6 years, in the seventh year you must let them go free. And when you release them, do not send them away empty-handed. Supply them liberally from your flock, your threshing floor, and your wine press. Give to them as the Lord your God has blessed you. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you. That is why I give you this command today. But if your servant says to you, I do not want to leave you because he loves you and your family and is well off with you, then take an awl and push it through his earlobe into the door, and he will become your servant for life. Do the same for your female servant. Do not consider it a hardship to set your servants free, because their service to you these 6 years has been worth twice as much as that of a hired hand, and the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. Set apart for the Lord your God every firstborn male of your herds and flocks. Do not put the firstborn of your cows to work, and do not shear the firstborn of your sheep. Each year you and your family are to eat them in the presence of the Lord your God at the place he will choose. If an animal has a defect, is lame or blind, or has any serious flaw, you must not sacrifice it to the Lord your God. You are to eat it in your own towns. Both the ceremonially unclean and the clean may eat it, as if it were gazelle or deer. But you must not eat the blood. Pour it out on the ground like water. Observe the month of Abath and celebrate the Passover of the Lord your God. Because in the month of Abath, he brought you out of Egypt by night. Sacrifice as the Passover to the Lord your God an animal from your flock or herd at the place the Lord will choose as a dwelling for his name. Do not eat it with bread made with yeast, but for 7 days eat unleavened bread, the bread of affliction, because you left Egypt in haste, so that all the days of your life you may remember the time of your departure from Egypt. Let no yeast be found in your possession in all your land for 7 days. Do not let any of the meat you sacrifice on the evening of the first day remain until morning. You must not sacrifice the Passover in any town the Lord your God gives you, except in the place he will choose as a dwelling for his name. There you must sacrifice the Passover in the evening, when the sun goes down, on the anniversary of your departure from Egypt. Roast it and eat it at the place the Lord your God will choose. Then in the morning return to your tents. For 6 days eat unleavened bread. And on the 7th day hold an assembly to the Lord your God and do no work. Count off 7 weeks from the time you begin to put the sickle to the standing grain. Then celebrate the festival of weeks to the Lord your God by giving a free will offering in proportion to the blessings the Lord your God has given you. And rejoice before the Lord your God at the place he will choose as a dwelling for his name. You, your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, the Levites in your towns, and the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows living among you. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt and follow carefully these decrees. Celebrate the festival of tabernacles for 7 days after you have gathered the produce of your threshing floor and your wine press. Be joyful at your festival. You, your sons and daughters, your male and female servants, and the Levites, the foreigners, the fatherless, and the widows who live in your towns. For 7 days, celebrate the festival to the Lord your God at the place the Lord will choose. For the Lord your God will bless you in all your harvest and in all the work of your hands, and your joy will be complete. Three times a year, all your men must appear before the Lord your God at the place he will choose. At the festival of unleavened bread, the festival of weeks, and the festival of tabernacles. No one should appear before the Lord empty-handed. Each of you must bring a gift in proportion to the way the Lord your God has blessed you. Appoint judges and officials for each of your tribes in every town the Lord your God is giving you, and they shall judge the people fairly. Do not pervert justice or show partiality. Do not accept a bribe, for a bribe blinds the eyes of the wise and twists the words of the righteous. Follow justice and justice alone, so that you may live and possess the land the Lord your God is giving you. Do not set up any wooden Asherah pole beside the altar you build to the Lord your God. And do not erect a sacred stone, for these the Lord your God hates. Do not sacrifice to the Lord your God an ox or a sheep that has any defect or flaw in it, for that would be detestable to him. If a man or woman living among you in one of the towns the Lord gives you is found doing evil in the eyes of the Lord your God, in violation of his covenant, and contrary to my command, has worshipped other gods, bowing down to them, or to the sun, or the moon, or the stars in the sky, and this has been brought to your attention, then you must investigate it thoroughly. If it is true and it has been proved that this detestable thing has been done in Israel, take the man or woman who has done this evil deed to your city gate and stone that person to death. On the testimony of two or three witnesses, a person is to be put to death, but no one is to be put to death on the testimony of only one witness. The hands of the witnesses must be the first in putting that person to death, and then the hands of all the people. You must purge the evil from among you. If cases come before your courts that are too difficult for you to judge, whether bloodshed, lawsuits, or assaults, take them to the place the Lord your God will choose. Go to the Levitical priest and to the judge who is in office at that time. Inquire of them, and they will give you the verdict. You must act according to the decisions they give you at the place the Lord will choose. Be careful to do everything they instruct you to do. Act according to whatever they teach you and the decisions they give you. Do not turn aside from what they tell you, to the right or to the left. Anyone who shows contempt for the judge or for the priest who stands ministering there to the Lord your God is to be put to death. You must purge the evil from Israel. All the people will hear and be afraid and will not be contemptuous again. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you and have taken possession of it and settled in it, and you say, "Let us set a king over us like all the nations around us," be sure to appoint over you the king the Lord your God chooses. He must be from among your own people. Do not place a foreigner over you, one who is not an Israelite. The king, moreover, must not acquire great numbers of horses for himself, or make the people return to Egypt to get more of them. For the Lord has told you, you are not to go back that way again. He must not take many wives, or his heart will be led astray. He must not accumulate large amounts of silver and gold. When he takes the throne of his kingdom, he is to write for himself on a scroll a copy of this law taken from that of the Levitical priest. It is to be with him, and he is to read it all the days of his life, so that he may learn to revere the Lord his God and follow carefully all the words of this law and these decrees, and not consider himself better than his fellow Israelites, and turn from the law to the right or to the left. Then he and his descendants will reign a long time over his kingdom in Israel. The Levitical priests, indeed, the whole tribe of Levi, are to have no allotment or inheritance with Israel. They shall live on the food offerings presented to the Lord, for that is their inheritance. They shall have no inheritance among their fellow Israelites. The Lord is their inheritance, as he promised them. This is the share due the priest from the people who sacrifice a bull or a sheep: the shoulder, the jowls, and the internal organs. You are to give them the first fruits of your grain, new wine and olive oil, and the first wool from the shearing of your sheep. For the Lord your God has chosen them and their descendants out of all your tribes to stand and minister in the Lord's name always. If a Levite moves from one of your towns anywhere in Israel where he is living, and comes in all earnestness to the place the Lord will choose, he may minister in the name of the Lord his God, like all other Levites who serve there in the presence of the Lord. He is to share equally in their benefits, even though he has received money from the sale of family possessions. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, do not learn to imitate the detestable ways of the nations there. Let no one be found among you who sacrifices their son or daughter in the fire, who practices divination or sorcery, interprets omens, engages in witchcraft, or casts spells, or who is a medium or spiritist, or who consults the dead. Anyone who does these things is detestable to the Lord, and because of these detestable practices, the Lord your God will drive out those nations before you. You must be blameless before the Lord your God. The nations you will dispossess, listen to those who practice sorcery or divination. But as for you, the Lord your God has not permitted you to do so. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your own people. You must listen to him. For this is what you asked of the Lord your God at Horeb, on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let us not hear the voice of the Lord our God, nor see this great fire anymore, or we will die." The Lord said to me, "What they say is good. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their people, and I will put my words in his mouth. He will tell them everything I command him. I myself will call to account anyone who does not listen to my words that the prophet speaks in my name. But a prophet who presumes to speak in my name anything I have not commanded, or a prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, is to be put to death." You may say to yourselves, "How can we know when a message has not been spoken by the Lord? If what a prophet proclaims in the name of the Lord does not take place or come true, that is..."
Inspired by The Bible Experience.
Do you think the devil loves the Sabbath? The devil hates the Sabbath. In fact, the devil has led Christians to despise the Sabbath, to call it a Jewish institution, to call it a yoke of bondage. But the fact is, the Sabbath is not a yoke of bondage. It's not a Jewish institution. Did Jesus only come to redeem the Jews? He came to redeem the whole human race. By the way, if you want to know how much the devil hates the Sabbath, all you have to do is look at the history of the Sabbath. That'll tell you how much the devil hates the Sabbath. From the moment that God gave the Sabbath in the fourth commandment, we're told that Israel trampled on the Sabbath. They worshiped the sun, they worshiped other gods, they trampled on the Sabbath. And so God says, okay, I'm going to send you to Babylonian captivity so that you learn to keep my Sabbath. And so Jeremiah 17 says that because they trampled on the Sabbath, they disobeyed it, they desecrated the Sabbath, God led them into captivity. But the devil, you know, the devil is very sly. So the devil says, I'm going to use this to my advantage. God wants to teach them to keep the Sabbath. Well, I'm going to tell them that they need to establish a whole bunch of laws that will make it impossible to break the Sabbath. And so the rabbis established this system of laws, rabbinical laws, supposedly to protect the Sabbath from being desecrated so that they're not taken captive again. Among those laws is, you could, if you had false teeth, you had to take them out of your mouth because that's carrying a burden on the Sabbath. If you have a prosthetic leg, you got to take the prosthetic leg off because that's bearing a burden on the Sabbath. You can't look in a mirror and pull out a hair on the Sabbath because that's the sin of plucking a hair on the Sabbath. You couldn't jump over a river because you might fall in and then you would get wet and you might fall into the sin of wringing your robe or your garment. Nowhere in the Bible do you find these rules and regulations. They were rabbinical rules and regulations. In other words, the devil led Israel from trampling on the Sabbath to idolizing the Sabbath and making the Sabbath a means of salvation. And the devil was preparing the way eventually for the Christians in the early church to look at the Sabbath and say, look at that Sabbath. It's a yoke of bondage. It's a bunch of rules and regulations. So let's not keep the Sabbath. Let's keep Sunday because it's a happy day. It's a day that honors the resurrection of Jesus. It's not that old Sabbath yoke of bondage full of rules and regulations. Are you understanding what the devil is doing? What the devil does, he leads Israel to trample on the Sabbath. Then he leads Israel to establish a mass of laws to protect the Sabbath, which makes the Sabbath a yoke of bondage, because eventually he wants to lead Christians to reject the Sabbath, thinking that the Sabbath of the Pharisees is the Sabbath of the Lord. Do you know that the rabbinical Sabbath is not really the Sabbath? It is a distortion of the Sabbath. Jesus didn't come to break the Sabbath. Jesus came to deliver the Sabbath from the mass of human laws that had made the Sabbath a yoke of bondage. Jesus would not give the Sabbath as a blessing, bless it and make it holy, and then curse the Sabbath and breaks the Sabbath. In fact, Jesus came to deliver the Sabbath from the bondage that had been created. And you know that Bible prophecy tells us that there was a little horn during the period of the Middle Ages that actually thought that it could change God's holy law. It's a church in the world today who says, we were the ones who changed the day of worship from Sabbath to Sunday. Let me ask you, who would like to see a change of the Sabbath from Sabbath to Sunday? God? No, it would be Satan. Because you see, the change in the Sabbath points to the person who changed it. The original Sabbath points to God who established it. So the question is, whose authority are you going to accept? God, who established the seventh-day Sabbath, or this power which established Sunday as the day of rest? The issue is not one day versus another. The issue is, whose authority do you accept? God's authority or man's authority? The Sabbath is a great blessing. I enjoy it. It reminds me of my great Creator. It reminds me of my great Redeemer. And it reminds me that soon we will be in the kingdom, in the new heavens and the new earth, wherein righteousness dwells.